And there's an application of that. You can actually have a survival sound and everything scans. You know, the extent that you want to increase the buffer up for constant or not, because they're more accurate like that. But if you do that, you actually decrease the complexity enormously in each of these vectors. And so depending on how the complexity scales with the couple logical constant, this can even overcompensate for the larger number of vector at larger lambda, and push you towards small lambda. Or you might end up with a flat distribution in log lambda. Or at the very least, and I think this is the most realistic case, you still need a cutoff like Weinberg did, but you're not pushed up so hard against it, so you can absorb a bigger thicker discrepancy. I don't think this is right for, you know, drawing strong conclusions from it, other than the fact that I think it's really important to try to estimate this rate factor as a function of the entropy difference, and especially as a function specifically of the cosmological constant. Because it predicts where we are in the landscape. And more important for the time being, I think, is that the wave factor does not depend on it. It does not depend on these exponentially large factors that are really hard to compute, like the lifetime of the vacuum, insertion volume expansion. Those things don't enter at all, other than that you want it to be stable enough to live until lambda dominates roughly, and you want insertion to last long enough to make sure curvature doesn't dominate and prevent you from harvesting free energy before the cosmological constant does so anyway. Okay. And you still solve the coincidence problem, because all of the entropy increases happening in the era when the cosmological constant is about starting to dominate. That's when the universe is already big, but not yet empty. Okay, so here's a summary. All of that cutoff allows you to compute probabilities in the thermalization in a well-defined way. You don't run into any of these huge ambiguities and topologies that take a global picture, and you end up with a simple matrix equation that's even easy to solve and allows useful approximations. The entropic principle is the idea that in step three, where you don't want to make any prior assumptions about what observers need to look like, you simply wait back here by an appropriate function of the entropy difference. That's to capture the potential complexity and the transfer observers to form. And at least in our universe, it works amazingly well. So maybe it really does capture this more general. You spin out of this medium, there are some vectors that you don't reach or that are entropically non-perturbed, but not nearly as much as if you have these hugely varying probabilities from the matrix kappa ij that you need in the global picture. And I think you're more predictive. I mean, the example of, you know, we should find the small charges turned off, that's not still very primitive, but it's a simple example that shows that it really needs some predictions for our vacuum. Thank you. Which is that, you know, if you're only interested in the problem in vacuum with small cosmological constants, and there, the thing you said about the concept, I said a lot of ingredients, each of which had nothing to do with that scale. That scale is accidental. And so the decay channel becomes easier with the scale of these various ingredients, and there are hundreds of them. So especially the fastest one is going to be much faster than this. But I think this is a very interesting condition to actually try to check. And I think we should look more at what fastest decay channels are, and if they satisfy this condition. This is a short talk, but a long title. So I'm going to say some work done in collaboration with Arthritica, Michele Cassetti, and Enrico Cicchini. The Rondo Sandra 1 model, as you all probably know, is a slice of 8 and 5 between 2-4 dimensional brains. Boundaries, and it's interesting for immunologists because of the depth of the hierarchy problem, because it has an interesting radio PSP demo, and because it has a piece of the extra dimensions. Should be on. Okay. So an interesting question is certainly how can such models be realized in string theory or in string complex decay? And the idea how to do this is, by now a couple of years old, you might know them how to be supergravity complex decay with bones and fluxes, which is what you develop with more strength. And we will now have a look at a couple of features of the 5-dimensional theory in comparison to the 10-dimensional theory in particular. We'll have a look at the fuzzy description of hierarchy cell levels in 10D. We'll have a look at the state of the universal and state of the scalar modulus in 5D, and especially we're going to investigate how really breaking can be mediated from the infrared to the ultraviolet. I think I'm just going to gloss over this because you're probably familiar with that, and we are looking at the given scatter effect where space-time is a block product of the four-dimensional cosmic space with a 60-calorie hour, and in some block third region the geometry is approximately radius 5 times 3-1-1, where this is a compact internal manifold of anthropology, and it also contains M units of 3-4 flux in the 3-cycle. It's not quite 88, but the radius of the internal manifold is curvature radius of the 88 values along the radius radial direction, and this looks pretty much like the three brain metric with an infected number of these three brains, which depends, as I was saying, on the position where we are in the set, and has a fast little flux to the 3-1-1, where fast little is given by a combination of these brains and potentials, and the overall picture would look like this. If you have an embedding into some compact calorie space, you would have an infrared brain, which is where the first easily terminates. Then we would have an ultraviolet fuzzy brain, which is some intermediate conical region plus the remainder of the compact manifold. And the throat itself would then be run a tangent box. And of course, some internal signal one. Okay, now, point one. Just can, as we know, stabilize complex spectrum moduli. How do we describe this in a five-dimensional context? And of course, the interval length is the modulus in pure angle one. Actually, we don't have pure angle tangent one. We have a deviation from ADS geometry in the throat, which is parameterized by one scalar degree of freedom, which is essentially reflected through the internal T11 and so on. And whose boundary values are fixed in the ultraviolet by the factorial cancellation conditions in the overall space and in the infrared by whatever plus you put. So if we compare this with those by the wife, which is the one uncellular mechanism for one model, also there the two functions of gravity and there the scalar degree of freedom with boundary values fixed. And the co-size at the boundary values then become in the interval length. Actually, the original proposal did not include the bisection of the scalar, but this is not a part of the feature in our context because we can determine the bar potential from requiring that the bisection gives rise to the correct information of the radius background which we want to have. And what we get out of this is some media strength. Okay, and the universal scalar modulus, which was largely explained by Steve Willis already, there is always at least one scalar modulus which remains massive and can't be stabilized as well. And if you want to have a look at this in the context of a 5D model, it could explain in some parameter region where it's important, it corresponds to a rescaling of the ultraviolet manifold rather than a rescaling of the overall internal manifold as it would have been the case without warping. What we can see from this is that there is an ultraviolet brain field in the 5D random sample picture which will turn out to be important for point number 3. Namely, now let's take a peek. Let's assume that the scalar modulus is stabilized along the curve of mu and that supersymmetry is broken in the infrared, for example, by anti-decrease, such that the vacuum is uplifted to be the good level of this cosmological logical function on the coffee site. And I took the standard model field somewhere into the ultraviolet. And since we don't have a direct coupling between the two sectors, that they are geometrically separated, this is the sequencing scenario. And we want the outcast completely basically mediated from the IR to the ultraviolet. And so, since we can really get a problem with this, the dominant effect will be the mixed modulus anomaly mediation. Actually, what we find out is that there may be other equally good contributions if we consider the specific case of the Kedemov-Schwarzschild event or some other 10-dimensional model where this comes from. So, let's model the fusibrating sector of X and breaking by tiling superfield X. Actually, how we make fusibrating won't really matter. We are just investigating the mediation effect. And let's assume that we'll have any structure that has modular integrated alpha equivalent. Then the whole thing would look like this. We have potentially only one constant and putting three sets of one. We have this some hierarchy parameter omega, which is much smaller than one. What happens in infrared and abundance like this, where C is the non-perturbably stabilized UV brain field, and since it's the UV brain field, we have sequestering in omega. And we have this term from non-perturbative stabilization, and this comes from the Hamming field. It turns out that you can estimate the contribution using the fusibrating model parameter. You can estimate the contribution to be of the omega squared. So if we add invisible effects and the ultraviolet, then the cross scale analysis will be elsewhere before the omega to the fourth. Now, if we take a concrete background with what from chemicals, then we have more potential mapping this year than it turns out that in particular vector superfields will contribute. We will have the base symmetry from the magnetometry of the entire space. In the case of four-dimensional theory, but this will be broken by embedding it into the manifold which doesn't reflect the algometry. So V will get the unique curve map, and we expect the fusion breaking effect to be charged under that gauge symmetry. So the whole thing gets modified like this, and here's the mass term for V. And it turns out if you work things out, you get the G term for V in the vacuum, which is like omega to the 4. So if we again add visible vector field, we'll be coupling now to V, that is charged under the vector, then we'll get top scale analysis of the same order as we get from this anomalous mass curve, anomalous modulus mediation. But this is actually a competing effect. Okay, let's summarize.